Fathers, I now bring to present the word before your people. I ask for the presence and the power of your Holy Spirit to be with me. I pray, Lord, I will decrease, and that may Christ may increase, and that all things may be done to your name's honor and glory, and your people will be fed spiritually. And above all, Father, we have our burning desire that we all shall be saved in the end of your eternal kingdom, we pray. So save us, the great God. In the end of your eternal kingdom, we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. I'm asking that those who have their cell phones, if it's on, check it again. Make sure it's on vibrate or if it's off. And if I have, I think I forgot. Unless you take in the message, of course. Also, Sister Dyke, I just want to thank you for your prayers. This morning she called me around the corner and she laid hands upon me and she said a prayer for me and made me, it helped to calm me down. It's not easy standing before God's people. You get a little nerves, you know? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. And darkness was upon the deep. And God said, let there be light. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And God saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the first day.
Amen.
Next, God created a firmament in the midst of the waters, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And the firmament he called heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. Then the Creator said, let the waters under the heavens be gathered unto one place, and let the dry land appear. God called the dry land earth, and he called the waters sea. And he created trees and herbs and grass in the seed after its kind, and fruits whose seed was in itself after its kind. And God saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the third day.
Yes.
Then the Creator divided lights in the heavens. And he said, let it be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. And he made two great lights, the greater to rule the day and the lesser to rule the night. He made the stars also. He set them in the firmament in the heavens and gave light upon the earth. And God saw that it was good. Then the evening and the morning were the fourth day. Oh, yes, the heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament showed forth his handiwork. Then as life giver, God created great whales and every living creature that moved, which the waters brought forth abundantly after its own kind. and every wing fall after its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply in the waters and in the sea, and let fowls multiply in the earth. And the evening and the morning were the fifth day. Then as the crowning act of his creation, God said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowls of the air and over the cattle and over everything that creepeth upon the earth. So in the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply. And God said, everything that he had made, behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Here we find the origin of the human race. Because there are those who firmly believe that the human race exists because of millions of years of evolution. And there are those that firmly believe that we came from monkeys. But this is a lie, because humanity came straight from the hands of the Creator. Humanity came straight from the hands of infinite wisdom, brethren. I ain't come from no monkey, brethren. Maybe they ain't came from a monkey. I came straight from the hands of the living God.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Now, after his work of creation, God rested, not as one weary or not as one tired, but as one well pleased in his perfect work of creation. The Bible in Genesis chapter 2. Let's turn quick to Genesis chapter 2, verse 1 to 3. The Bible says, thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the hosts of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made. And he rested on the seventh day from all the work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified, because in it he had rested from all his work which he had created and made. Now notice where God created the world in six literal days, but we have 7 days in a week. Even God in his infinite wisdom added one more day to the weekly cycle. He added a day of rest, a day of sweet communion, a day of worship, a day of sweet reflection, a day of rest and gladness, a day to mend broken relationships. He created a temple, not a physical temple, but a spiritual temple in time. And every Sabbath day of the Sabbath song, we by faith enter into his holy temple in time that God has set us in the beginning of the earth. So I don't know about you, brethren, but I love this Sabbath. I look forward to entering this holy temple in time that God has set up since the beginning of the earth. I look forward to being among God's people, and this is blessed and holy Sabbath day. It's a day that he has blessed. It's a day that he has sanctified and set apart for holy use, brethren.
Amen.
Excuse me. Now, inspiration says that if this Sabbath had only been observed the way in which it was intended, there will never be an unbeliever. There will never be an atheist. And there will never be an infidel. For they will know that God created the world in six literal days and rested on the seventh day. For they will know it's the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise. It's the mighty power of God that built the lofty skies. It's the mighty power of God why the birds fly so high. Oh yes, the moon shines full at his command, and all the stars obey, brethren. All things humble are the power of God, brethren.
Amen.
Now I'm one who preacher. Now I'm one who firmly believes that one of the reasons why the world is so corrupt is because men have forgotten the God of the seven-day Sabbath. In a world where it seems to be spinning madly out of control, God is saying, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. In a world where everyone seems to be overworked and stressed out, God is saying, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. In a world where men are jostling for supremacy one over the other, God is saying, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the Sabbath day, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. Yes. Now, the day before the Sabbath is what? What's the day before the preparation day? No, I give it to you, it's the preparation day. The day before the Sabbath is the preparation day. I don't know why I did that. That's Exodus 16. So on the preparation day, let your next door neighbor see you sweeping. Let them see your shoe and your car shining. Let them see your children smiling. Let them smell food cooking. At the set of sun, let them hear voices singing, brethren, at the preparation of the Sabbath day. You see, brethren, there are a few things that God calls holy. The Bible said that the tithe is holy. It's not yours. Return to God. Marriage is holy. The people who are called by his name are holy. Your temple is holy. God's name is holy, and the Sabbath is holy. You see, brethren, we lose one all of the blessing the way we treat God's holy day. Some of us, we are still speaking our own words on God's holy day. Some of us, we are still cooking food on God's holy day. Some of us, we are still watching secular TV programs on God's holy day. Some of us, we are doing all pleasures last night. And then we come to church the next Sabbath morning acting all holy and acting all pious as if nothing ever happened. But in heaven, the records declare that we are transgressors of God's holy law. We may hide from men, but we just can't hide from God. And there's a work of Sabbath reform that must be done among God's people. Those who are preparing for Christ's second coming, there's a work of Sabbath reform that must be done amongst God's people. Because if we ourselves are desecrating God's holy day, how are we to stand in defense of it, brethren? And if we ourselves are trampling upon God's holy law, how are we to stand for it when the crisis comes? We can't stand for something we ourselves are desecrating it, brethren. Inspiration declared, the Sabbath will be the great test of loyalty. For it is the point of truth especially controverted. When the final test shall be brought to bear upon men, then the line of distinction will be drawn between those who serve God and those who serve him not. While the observance of the four Sabbaths in compliance with the laws of the state, contrary to the fourth commandment, will be our approval of allegiance to a power that is in opposition to God, the keeping of the true Sabbath in obedience to God's law is evidence of loyalty to the Creator. Now, Elder James, yeah, their first day worshiper said to me, or seventh day worshiper said to me, said, Brother Vic, man, what's this big deal about this 7 day Sabbath, man? You can worship God at any day of the week and get a blessing. And he's right. But what I said to him, I said, Brother, you can worship God on any day of the week and get a blessing. You can worship God on Sunday and get a blessing. You can worship God on Monday and get a blessing. On Tuesday and get a blessing. On Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday and get a blessing. You can even worship God on all 4 days and get a blessing. But if you want to get the Sabbath day's blessing, you got to when he has placed it and was on the seventh day. And if you have your opinion to God, you will worship God on the seventh day. And if you will ride upon the high place of the earth, you will worship God on the seventh day. And if you will be fed with the heritage of Jacob, you will worship God on the seventh day. And I'm not saying it. Ella Norman not saying it. Ella Johnson not saying it. Pastor Peter not saying it. But the mouth of the Lord has said it. Because this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Now, the Bible in Ezekiel chapter 20 and verse 12. He said, "Moreover, I gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between me and them, that they may know that I am the Lord that sanctify them." Also in Exodus chapter 31, verse 16 and 17 says, "Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath day, to observe the Sabbath day throughout their generation, for it's a perpetual covenant. It's also a perpetual sign of creation, a perpetual sign of redemption, a perpetual sign of restoration for us. It will be a perpetual sign throughout all eternity." Inspiration declared the Sabbath is a memorial of creation. It is a token of the love and the power of Christ. It calls our thoughts to nature and brings us into communion with our Creator. Amen? Now, the Bible in Leviticus chapter 23. That's Leviticus chapter 23. And we'll read from, let's say, verse 23. "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, In the seventh month, in the first day of the month, shall ye have a Sabbath, a memorial of the blowing of trumpets and holy convocation." Verse 26, "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Also on the tenth day of the seventh month there shall be a day of atonement. It shall be a holy convocation unto you, and you shall afflict your souls and an offering made by fire unto the Lord." Now, the number seven. It's a perfect number. Or a six followed by a seven signifies perfection. It's a number of completeness, a number of fullness, and throughout the scriptures, the number and the cycle of seven seems to reoccur over and over and over from Genesis to Revelation. For example, there are 7 days in a weekly cycle. 7 years of prosperity followed by 7 years of famine in the days of Joshua. Samson had seven locks. This priest sprinkled the blood with his finger seven times. 70 years of captivity in Babylon. Christ told Peter, "Get to forgive your brother 70 times seven. Seven candlesticks in the sanctuary. Seven seals. Seven elders. Seven last plagues. Seven churches." I can go on and on and on and on. So whatever it is, 7 days, 7 months, 7 years, 7 lots, 7,000, seven is God's number of perfection. Joshua, when I round Jericho seven times on the seventh day before the walls of Jericho came tumbling down, brethren. And sometimes we are facing situations where we gotta go down on our knees and restrain God seven times before Satan's defense can come tumbling down, brethren. And brother Naaman, he had to go down in the Jordan and wash seven times before his leprosy was cleansed. And sometimes we have to go down on our knees and seven times before that demon can be cast out of our homes. Sometimes we have to go down on our knees seven times before we can get the victory over sin, brethren. Sometimes we may have to intercede with God seven times for a husband, 7 times for a wife, 7 times for a children, 7 times for a brother, 7 times for a sister, 7 times for a mother, 7 times for a father. But I guarantee you, on the 7th time, you'll start to see a change in your situation, brethren. I guarantee you, on the 7th time, you'll see God's Spirit moving on your situation, brethren. Just go on your knees 7 times. The Bible in Psalms 90 verse 4 says, for 1,000 years in this sight are but as yesterday when it's past, and as a watch in the night. Also in 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 8, the Bible says, but beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. So today, by the will of God, it's my prayer and I hope that I can prove to you that we are living in the last days. It's my prayer and I hope that we are living at a time of anticipation. So today, by the will of God, I pray and hope to you and prove to you that we are coming to the end of a 6,000-year period, which will be followed by a 1,000 years millennial rest of Revelation 20. Now, brethren, as soon as there was a sinner, there was a Savior.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
I said, as soon as there was a sinner, there was a Savior. And at the very inception of sin into our world, the plan of salvation went into effect immediately. Yes. Mercy and grace was granted to our first parents, Adam and Eve, before they even asked. You see, God knew that man would try to wear the apron of their own righteousness to cover his own nakedness, when it's only the garment of Christ's righteousness can cover the transgression of his holy law. The Lord Jesus in Genesis 3 prepared a covering. He prepared a robe, a symbol of his righteousness to cover the repentant sinner. So a lamb was slain from the foundation of the earth. And it was there in the Garden of Eden that Adam and Eve had to witness the first death. They witnessed the blood of the innocent lamb that was slain for their own sins. And then God took the skin of the innocent victim, made a coat to cover their nakedness. He made a sheepskin coat of his righteousness. I guess that's why people who are prominent in society love to wear expensive sheepskin coat. I guess this is where it came from. You know, there are some coats you can go in the store and spend $20 and $30 and get a coat. Guys like me. And then there are those who wear expensive mink coats. $10,000, $20,000, $30,000. Those who live the lifestyle of the rich and famous. One of my clients said to me, he said, Vic, I'm a proud owner of a $10,000 mink coat. I was like, Lord, $10,000 for a coat. But I'm here to declare unto you that the sheepskin coat of Christ's righteousness, it is priceless, brethren.
Amen.
So in the factory of God's infinite love produced the first sheepskin coat. And God, with his amazing grace, has prepared a sheepskin coat for the whole human family to wear. He made a sheepskin coat of his righteousness. It's priceless. It's perfect because we all can wear by faith the righteousness of Jesus Christ. The white man can wear it. The black man can wear it. The tall can wear it. The short can wear it. The good, the bad, not so good, we all by faith can wear the righteousness of Jesus Christ, brethren.
Amen.
But this was just the beginning of the sin problem, or the disease of sin. and we are working our way to the Sabbath. Now, Elder Johnson, I was online the other day. I was viewing some biblical chronological site. And using the Bishop Usher's chronology, I was amazed when I discovered that from creation from Adam to Abraham was 2,000 years of Earth's history. Which makes perfect sense because the good news of the gospel didn't rock the house of Abraham. The Bible in Genesis 22 says, 22 verse 1, it says, God told Abraham, take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. Now this command came to Abraham when he was an old man, when he was approximately 120 years old. It came to him when he longed for some rest, peace, and tranquility. But the servant of the Lord must obey the voice of the Lord, because by works, faith is made perfect. Moreover, the command was so clear, precise, and urgent that he dared not awake in sorrow to let them know the Lord had commanded. Abraham is a very smart man. If he had made a mistake that day, I woke up sorrow and let her know what the Lord had commanded. Somebody would have been the slain that day. I knew it was going to be Isaac. Because Isaac was a pride and joy. Her life was wrapped up in his life. And the mother's love for her child would not allow the sacrifice to take place. Could you imagine me, Brother Joshua? Wake up my wife early in the morning and tell her, wake up. The Lord said, let's take Gracie and go sacrifice her somewhere in the mountain. Oh, I tell you, my wife is a sweet, humble, loving woman. I tell you, she don't kill me. You don't play that woman's child. So, in an act of obedience, Abraham rose up early in the morning, put the saddle on the donkey. The wood was made ready, placed on the donkey. He took Isaac, two of his servants, and they started a three-day journey. Now these weren't three regular days, brethren. They were like three decades to Abraham. There were 3 days of suffering. There were 3 days of pain. There were 3 days of carrying a heavy, heavy burden on his heart. Inspiration declared in the still of the night, while Isaac and the young man were sleeping, Abraham was on his knees, praying and pleading to God, hoping that God would say, enough is enough, you have suffered enough, let the boy return unharmed to his mother. But he got no answer, because sometimes as Christians we are called to suffer disappointment, sometimes we are called to suffer pain, sometimes we are called to suffer affliction for character perfection. Now it was on the third day that the father and son made their way up Mount Moriah, with the wood being placed upon the back of Isaac, the one who was to be sacrificed. Abraham designed that none shall witness the parting scene. He told his servants, abide here with the beast. I and the yard will go under to worship, and while they were walking up the mountain, Isaac was perplexed. He saw fire. He saw wood. He saw light, but he saw no lamb. So he decided to ask his father illogical question. He said, my father, we have the fire. My father, we have the wood. My father, we have the knife. But where is the lamb for the burnt offering? It was like a lamb asking a lion what's for dinner. Abraham replied, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for the burnt offering. Amen? Amen. God will provide himself a lamb for the burnt offering. Genesis 22 verse 8. And when they got to the top of the mountain, Abraham built an altar, placed the wood on the altar. Then he revealed to Isaac what the Lord had commanded. It was in shock and amazement that Isaac found out this faith. Now, Isaac was a strong, strapping young man. He could have said, my father, not me. Somebody else, but not me. But he had been trained from a child in trusting, loving, obedience to the will of God. I say it again. He had been trained from a child in trusting, loving, obedience to the will of God. Because we live in a generation of some disrespectful children, brethren. All you have is going to train sometime, just watch. And sadly, even among the house of faith, we have some disrespectful children. So Isaac willingly submitted himself to the Father's will. It was there on top of the mountains where the last words were spoken. The last tears were shed. The last hug, the last kisses were given. It was very emotional. The father lifted up his knife to slay his son when behold, the angel of the Lord called out. As a matter of fact, let's turn to Genesis chapter 22. And we'll start from verse 11. And the angel of the Lord called out unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here I am. And he said, lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing that thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes, and he looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in thickets by his horn. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering instead of his son. Amen?
Amen.
Now that ram that was slain on that day is symbolic of Jesus.
Amen.
It represents the sacrifice that will be made for the whole human family, and the penalty of sin will be placed upon Jesus. And every turtle dove pointed to Jesus. Every lamb that was slain pointed to Jesus. Every bullock that was slain pointed to Jesus. It all pointed to the day when God will send Christ to be to pay the infinite sacrifice for us on the cross of God. Come on, church. Let somebody say amen.
Amen.
That Lamb of God was slain on our behalf, brethren.
Amen.
And we should be forever grateful and forever thankful. But that was only 2,000 years of Earth's history. And we are working our way to the Sabbath. The songwriter said, welcome, welcome. Ever welcome, blessed Sabbath day. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome. Blessed Sabbath day. Now from Abraham to Christ was another 2,000 years of Earth's history. So let's now fast forward another 2,000 years. The Bible in 1 John chapter 1 verse 29. The Gospel of John 1:29. The next day John saw Jesus coming unto him and said, behold, the Lamb of God which take away the sins of the whole world. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that praise the Lord. Inspiration declared. Jesus was standing at the point of transition between two economies with the two great festivals. He, the spotless Lamb of God, was about to present himself as a sin offering, that he would thus bring to an end the system of types and ceremonies that for 4,000 years appointed to his death. As he ate the Passover with his disciples, he instituted in his place the service that was to be a memorial of his great sacrifice. Amen?
Amen.
Now Jesus, our Savior, the spotless Lamb of God, the Savior of the world, he was arrested in Gethsemane. He was dragged to and fro from judgment hall to judgment hall, from palace to judgment hall. He was arraigned twice before the priests, twice before the Sanhedrin council, twice before Pilate, twice he was tortured by scourging, and once before Herod. He was mocked, condemned to die, then led out to be crucified, bearing the heavy burden of the cross up Golgotha's mountain. He fainted beneath the burden of the cross, the spot upon his. He suffered the shame of the cross. And those hands are so often reached out in missions of love and mercy was stretched out and nailed to the cross. And those feet that walk on the dusty streets and missions of love and mercy was nailed to the cross. And upon the head of the King of Glory was placed a crown of thorns. And he did it all for you. He did it all for me. Oh yes, he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. He died the death that we deserve, so we can have the life that he deserved. What infinite love! What a savior! What a redeemer! Some writer says, redeem, redeem. Redeem by the blood of the Lamb. Redeem, redeem. His child forever, I am. And though your sins be as scarlet, he can make it white as snow. And there that be a red as crimson, they shall be as well. Oh yes, he came down from heaven, so that one day we can be caught up to meet him in the air. He was bound to the cross so that we can be set free. He wore a crown of thorns so that one day we can wear a crown of glory. He became part of the human family so that one day we can be part of the heavenly family. Amen? Amen. The song writer said, the cross is where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart run away. It was there by faith that I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. You see, at the cross, a transfer of power took place, brethren. At the cross, Christ takes away my self-righteousness and gave us his righteousness. At the cross, he took away mine. He says, give me your sinful weakness and I will give you my strength. Yes. At the cross, he took away the death penalty and gave me life for eternity, brethren. Yes. At the cross, he took away my imperfection and gave me his perfection. Yes. At the cross, tight. He said, to those that perish, the preacher of the cross is garbage. The preacher of the cross means absolutely nothing. The preacher of the cross is foolishness. But to us who are saved, it's the power of God unto salvation. At the cross, there's power to climb every mountain. There's power to overcome every obstacle. There's power to cast out every demon. There's power to overcome the lust of the flesh. There's power to live above the crown. And so I thank God for the cross of Calvary. Thank God each and every day, brother, for the cross of Calvary. Where would we be if it wasn't for the cross of Calvary? You see, one of the false accusations that Satan brought against the government of heaven is that mercy destroyed justice. But the devil is a liar, because of the cross, mercy and justice met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. The condemnation was removed. The whole human race was placed under grace. The whole human race had been set free from the penalty of death. The human race had been redeemed from the curse of the law. I thank God for the cross of Calvary. Because God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. You see, when man was condemned to die because of the transgression of God's holy law, the father looked upon his son and said, die. Then he turned to the sinner and said, live, for I found a ransom. So in the judgment, when the father looked upon you, he wouldn't see your nakedness. When he looked upon me, he wouldn't see my sinfulness. When he looked upon us, he wouldn't see our shame. But what he would see is us covered from head to toe with the righteousness of Jesus Christ, brethren. Well, don't sit there for 1 minute and think I'm preaching some kind of cheap grace, brethren. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is free, but it's not cheap, brethren. Our salvation costs the precious, precious blood of Jesus. So Christ will only offer the merits of his righteousness to those who are striving each and every day for the mastery over sin, for those who are striving every day for the victory over sin, for those who are striving by God's grace to overcome every sin that's known to man. That's the people Christ will impute his righteousness to, brethren. As the message of the uplifted Savior must be given to the whole world, brethren.
Amen.
And this is the message must go forth to the four corners of the earth. This message will rock Europe. It'll rock India. It'll rock China. It'll rock Africa and all the isles of the sea. The message of the uplifted Savior, a loving Redeemer. We have been justified by faith and invited the whole human family to receive freely the righteousness of Jesus Christ, which is made manifest by obedience to all of his commandments.
Amen.
Which is made manifest by obedience to all of his commands. You see, when it comes to the righteousness by faith message, God have a controversy with his people. God got a controversy with Adventism. He got a controversy with Laodicea. Because we think that we are rich, increased with goods, and in need of nothing, and we think that everything is okay between ourselves and God, and we don't know that we are lukewarm, poor, miserable, blind, and naked. And God is calling his people to repentance. The Bible said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then only then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. Spiritual sickness, mental sickness, physical sickness. God wants to heal his people today.
Yes.
Right? Now, our suffering, bleeding, dying Savior declared, it is finished. Bowed his head, gave up the ghost. The lamb was slain. The veil was torn from top to bottom. A pathway was made into the holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. And he rested that Sabbath day in his complete work of man's redemption. Now that was 4,000 years of earth's history, and we are working our way to the Sabbath. The songwriter says, welcome, welcome, ever welcome, blessed Sabbath day. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome, blessed Sabbath day. Now we need to fast forward approximately another 2,000 years. Which brings us down to our generation. And I can declare very confidently that this is the last generation on earth, brethren.
Yes, sir.
Not only is it the last generation, but we are coming to the end of the last generation. The sun is about to set on the history of this world. We are right at the end of a 6,000-year period, and the 1,000-year millennium rest of Revelation 20 is soon to begin. That's why we are seeing the rise of sodomy. That's why we are seeing the rise in crimes and murder and crime. That's why we are seeing calamities by land and by sea. That's why we see the rise in natural disasters, a rise of the papal system, a rise in pandemic sickness and diseases. And the greatest sign that Christ is coming is that despite all that's going on, right at this transition point from the sixth millennium to the seventh millennium, is God's people are sleeping. The greatest sign of Christ is not what's going on out there, brothers. But it's our attitude as God's people. Christ is soon to come, and we are still sleeping. You see, from one millennium to another, from the beginning to now, it was somewhat peaceful. The earth was able to transition from one millennium to another, peacefully, despite it being cursed by sin. But the transition from the sixth millennium to the seventh millennium will involve a struggle, brethren. It will involve a tremendous struggle with the powers of darkness. It will involve a time of trouble, not ceasing. There was a nation desert. Because Satan, the prince of the air, he's not willing to relinquish his kingdom without a fight. Because the beginning of the millennium signifies the end of Satan, the end of his reign, and the end of his kingdom, and he's not willing to relinquish his kingdom. He's willing to put up a fight, bro. You see, for 6,000 years, Satan's work of rebellion has made the earth to tremble. For 6,000 years, Satan's prison has held God's people captive. And it's his desire to hold God's people captive forever. But I thank God for Jesus, brethren. I say I thank God for Jesus, brethren. For he has broken the bonds of the enemy, and he has set the captives free. And as Christ suffered and died, at the end of that sixth day, right before the Sabbath, most of Christ's suffering and his humiliation took place right before the Sabbath, brethren. I'll say it again. It was just before the Sabbath that Christ hung on the cross. It was in the sixth day that Christ was tortured, he was beaten, and placed on the cross on the preparation day. And those who are counted worthy to enter his rest will go through a very similar experience. We will suffer for the weekly Sabbath day just before the 1,000-year Sabbath. Y'all don't get me? We will suffer for the literal weekly Sabbath just before the 1,000-year Sabbath. There will be arrest. There will be injustices. There will be unfair trials. There will be imprisonment and martyrdom. Come on, y'all don't go quiet to me now. Say amen. Amen. You see, the day before the Sabbath is the preparation day. As Christians, we should be prepared for the events that are connected with the sixth millennium to the seventh millennium. And this preparation is spiritual, mental, and physical. This preparation includes studying God's word, reading God's word, meditating upon God's word, and then applying God's word to our lives. As God's faithful people, we will be tried to the utmost, brethren. We will be tested to the utmost. We will fight the good fight. We will keep the faith, because when the Son of Man cometh, he will find faith on the earth, brethren. Amen? Because it's at the coming of Christ that we're ushering the millennium reign. And he's coming as conqueror. He's coming with his angels. He's coming in power. And he's coming in glory. Let's get ready, brethren. This time it's about to begin. Yeah. We are getting ready to go home, brethren. I'm losing my voice. Yes. You see, at the very beginning of sin, a lamb was slain. Yes. 2,000 years later, on top of Moriah, a ram was slain. Yes. 2,000 years later, on top of Golgotha's mount, Christ was slain. Someone or something must be slain in the end. Those who have rejected his mercy, those who have rejected his grace, they will be slain at his coming. They will run the mountains, they find us, and hide us from the face of the land, for the great day of his wrath has come. Who shall be able to stand? For the Lord in himself from descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet them in the clouds, and to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Hence he has laid up a crown of righteousness which the Lord shall give us on that day. Amen?
Amen.
The Bible, one more scripture, brethren. Grab your Bibles quickly. Turn to Job chapter 5. And verse 19. The Bible says, he shall deliver thee in six troubles, yea, in the seven no evil shall touch thee, brethren.
Amen.
In the seven millennium no evil shall come nigh us, brethren.
Yes.
For in 1,000 years no evil shall touch us. God's people will be set free from the penalty of sin. We'll be set free from the power of sin, and we'll be set free from the presence of sin, brethren. No devil to tempt, no devil to annoy. We'll live and reign with Christ throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity. For 1,000 years the saints shall judge the world. Yeah, we shall even judge angels. For 1,000 years redeemed will rest in God's complete work of restoration. We will live and reign with Christ for 1,000 years, the Redeemer of all ages. They will be finally united, brethren. We will be united with the patriarchs and prophets of old. The Abrahams and Isaacs and Jacob, we will all see them face to face. Most of all, we will enjoy communion with our Lord face to his face.
Amen.
The men who love and fear the Lord, they will see their joy fulfilled. There will be hope fulfilled. Love will be fulfilled, Lord, in that 1,000 years, brethren. Sin have dwarfed the human race. We will grow to our real stature, brethren. And within that 1,000 years, those who are midgets, they're going to grow to 16, 17 feet tall, brethren.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
No more sickness, no more disease, for the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nation, brethren. We will live and reign with Christ for 1,000 years.
Amen.
Brethren, we are living today at that transition point.
Yes.
Between the sixth millennium to the seventh millennium. And it's not going to go one day above 6,000, because then you went over into the seventh. That cannot happen. No, and the day or the hour, I don't know. I ain't preaching no day of the hour. But what I'm saying is that we are right there. Things gonna change swiftly, suddenly in our world. But the said inspiration says that great changes are soon to take place in this world, and these changes will be overnight, they will be sudden. Say, no time to be playing around with sin, brethren. Christ is soon to come. Ain't no time to be playing around with your salvation. Time is running out on the planet called Earth. We are living in the last days of Earth's history. Ain't no time to be playing around. Jesus is soon to come.
Yes.
We are living at that transition point. And all those, now Peterson, all those, organist, give me something there, please. All those who want to be prepared from the sixth millennium to the seventh millennium. If you know you ain't living right, brethren. If you know you ain't living right, brethren, by God's grace, things gonna change very suddenly. We can wake up one, I remember waking up at 9/11. Someone called me, said, Victor, check on the TV. I put on the TV, and since 9/11, the whole world has been a different place, brother. And the final event is going to come in the very same manner. We're going to wake up one day, and the world will be forever changed. And it's my prayer that all of us here will be saved when Christ comes.
Amen.
I don't want to see none of my brethren lost. I want to sit in glory with each and every one of you, brethren. And the Lord desired, but the only thing that will keep us out of heaven is sin. So if you know there's someone in your heart that you know by God's grace, you need to say, Lord, cleanse it from my heart, now is the accepted time. So all those who want to be ready from the sixth millennium to the seventh millennium, stand up, let's pray, brethren. Christ is soon to come, brethren. And ask Ella Johnson to pray for us today. Our Father, who art in heaven, what manner of man you have chosen today to preach from Genesis to Revelation and to step in and tell us about eternity. Oh Father, it is indeed a privilege that we can present ourselves in your courts today. It is a privilege we have the gift of hearing. It's a privilege that we have the gift of understanding. It is indeed a privilege and a blessing to honor and worship on the Sabbath day. Lord, we thank you for your servant. We thank you for the words of life. Lord, after hearing such words, we stood to our feet, and here we are standing, O Lord, to rededicate our lives to your soon coming. Lord, what can we tell you that you don't already know? But we come asking for mercy. We come asking for cleansing. We come asking for strength and courage and determination to live a clean, pure, and holy life. Lord, into your hands, we commit every family represented here today. May your blessing attend us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.